here. If we have any visitors, we have a tear out in the bulletin. If you would fill that out and put it in the offering plate, that would be great so we can get to know more about you. Let's go over the announcements. Today at 4 p.m. we'll have choir practice for the Christmas cantata, and at 5 p.m. we'll have Awanas. Tomorrow, Monday, 10 a.m. WMU meeting, and 6:30 p.m. we'll have the deacons meeting. Tuesday, 10:30 a.m. Rest Home Ministry. The van leaves at 10 a.m. for Westfield Rehab and Nursing. And Wednesday, 5 p.m. Missions Committee meeting. 5:45 will be choir practice, and 7 p.m. will be prayer and Bible study. Thursday, 11 a.m. Ladies Ensemble practice. Also listed in the bulletin are items that are needed for the Operation Christmas Child, so I won't go over those. You can look at those in your bulletin. Holly Springs Food Pantry Box Assembly will be Friday, November the 15th at 8 a.m. at Holly Springs Baptist Church. And the distribution night will be Monday, November 18th from 5 to 7 p.m. And also on the back it says 2019 Christmas poinsettia orders will be taken during the month of November. Order forms will be in the church foyer out there. Suggested donation is $10 per plant. They'll be decorating in the sanctuary a poinsettia tree. Plants can be purchased in honor or memory of someone that you love. Please complete the order form and turn into Debbie Morrison or the Sunday School Secretaries. Are there any other announcements?
Sandy,
uh-huh.
We have a nominate committee Tuesday night for those on the nominating committee.
Mm-hmm.
It's 7 o'clock.
Okay.
Everybody, let's see. Okay. Just letting everybody just give them a heads up.
Okay. Any other announcements? Stacy?
We would just like to thank everyone who participated and donated for the Fall Festival. We're all here, so it was a success. And I saw the cake table grow and grow and grow. I wasn't sure, but I think I told Pastor or somebody that it kind of reminded me of the story of the fish and the loaves of bread and how, it was kind of, yes, and it did. It multiplied a lot. And we even had, the adults had a round of cake walking. And if you weren't there, you missed a good time because I think we had more fun cake walking than the kids did. But anyway, thank you, and it was good.
Any other announcements? Yeah, let's give Stacy a big round of applause because she took that back. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we just thank you so much for allowing us to be here today and worship you. Thank you for our family and friends, Lord. Thank you for believers, dear God. And I pray for those that do not know you, that they will come to know you, Lord, before it's too late. Dear God, just please help us to have our ears open to the message today. And just please bless us and keep us safe throughout this day. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
Please join us in singing In the Garden, hymn number 187. Stand if you're able, please.
Love you. Thank you. Thank you for this week that we've had. I pray, Father, those that couldn't be here today, Lord. Just watch over them, Father. Lord, please bless these tithes and offerings. We pray, Lord, to use them where we need to be most. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
Didn't surprise me at all. I've seen it so many times before. But this sermon I've been working on for some time. It's been revised a dozen times. I've even got little fill-in notes on the one I have now that I've written in just last night. But I didn't time it for this day until the pastor called me and said, you know, I need you to replace me in the pulpit, you know, on this day and so forth. I said, good. He said, you got something worked out? I said, I just finished the sermon. And the title of it is All Christians Are Called, All Christians Are Gifted, and All Christians Are Sent. And you know what our Sunday school lesson was about this morning? I'd completed the sermon notes and had them in order before I studied my Sunday school lesson. And the Sunday school lesson was about God's gifts. So, is it amazing? No, it's not. If you do what God leads you to do, things in the church fall in order and things get done, okay? Now, starting off, point number one, all Christians are called. And why do I say called? Oh, yeah, forgot that again. Children, age 3 to grade 5. You have to go with this gentleman here, this nice lady. I got scripture to back it up, and if I do, I'll tell you beforehand, this is my opinion, it doesn't come from scripture. But this is scripture. 1 Timothy 2:4. Oh, and a note, side note. If you're taking notes on the sermon, and I know some of you do, I've seen you do it in the audience before, don't try to look up these scriptures, because you're not going to have time. I have one simple scripture, I have a series of scriptures, I'll give you as references when I get to the point where they are pertinent. And just write down the scripture. 1 Timothy 2:4 says, God desires all men to be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. The truth. And what is the knowledge of the truth, and how do we gain this knowledge of the truth? Each born-again Christian that names the name of Christ as Savior and Lord is first called by the Holy Spirit. This point or this lesson was emphasized to me some months ago when I got a book that Mickey gave me. It was from their pastor they had in California. And his name is John MacArthur, right? And he's a very influential, very intelligent, a very Christian man. I've enjoyed reading from him. This is something, this message is based on something that he said should be preached in each Christian church at least once a year. Okay? And that's what we're going to get to in just a minute, okay? But I give him the credit for creating this and starting this, okay? What is this knowledge of the truth? Like I said, each Christian is first called by the Holy Spirit. The knowledge of the ability of a person, or the truth is the ability of a person to see himself as being lost. You cannot get saved unless you first acknowledge the fact that you're lost. That you first acknowledge the fact that you're a sinner. Okay? John 15:16, Jesus says, this is very important, you have not chosen me, I have chosen you. And the warning that, I don't know if he's a doctor or not, should I call him Dr. MacArthur? Dr. MacArthur in California makes the point here, is the fact that so many times in literature, and even in churches, it's so simple to become a Christian according to the way they do it. If you look in the front of our Sunday school book, open the cover, inside the front cover, it's a little thing about how to get saved. I read that again this morning before I came to church. Nowhere in there does it mention the Holy Spirit or God. It simply says, if you want to get saved, you need to pray this prayer, admit you're a sinner, you know, and then we'll welcome you into the kingdom of God and we'll welcome you as a member of the church. Dr. MacArthur says it's his belief, and to his sorrow, that many people are sitting in churches today across this land, comfortable in their, quote, Christianity, unquote, and certain that when they die, they're going to heaven. And they have a sad fact facing them, they're going to wake up in hell. Because he said the truth about salvation is not put out the way it needs to be put out. It's more or less, if you want to be a Christian, you do this, and you become a Christian. Nowhere in this is the Christ or the Holy Spirit mentioned. if Christ doesn't call you through his Holy Spirit, usually how he does it, whenever you got your salvation experience, if Christ wasn't part of it, if he wasn't entered into it, the Holy Spirit wasn't bugging you, nagging you, whispering to you, telling you you need to be saved, and you walk the aisle, I got news for you. You're not saved. You need to check your salvation, okay? John 15:16, you have not chosen me, but I have chosen you, okay? There's this knowledge of the truth of each of us is a sinner, the truth of being lost, the truth of needing to be saved. It's important to realize that we don't decide to save ourselves. We can only respond to the Holy Spirit. The Lord's timing is always right. And when the Lord desires to touch your heart, he'll do so. When I was a teenager growing up, I grew up in a church with a pastor who was my dad's best friend. They grew up together in the mountains in North Carolina, Yancey County, grew tobacco and so forth. And this guy was very plain. He wasn't an educated man, but he knew his Bible and he preached it from cover to cover. And I learned from him. And I kept asking my dad. A lot of times he would visit us and him and dad would sit on the front porch and talk about what had been and so forth. And I'd sit and listen to him. And I'd ask him, I must ask a dozen times, you know, when am I going to get saved? You know what my dad would say to me? My dad told me, said, son, you'll know. You'll know the time. And it happened that way. I was 13 years old in South Carolina, where I was living at the time with my parents and all. It's Peach Center of the nation, they claim. And there's a lot of what we call peach sheds, where peaches are picked and processed, you know, on site. And these are usually just a roof with poles holding them up and all the sides open. The tractors come and dump the peaches and they run down the line and people pick out the bad ones and the green ones and the little ones and the knobby ones and take the biggest, nicest, reddest, beautiful ones and arrange them on top, you know, with a basket so you can buy them and see them and so on. And whenever peach season is over in September, where I grew up, we had revival in September before school started. School started late then. And I went. And we had put sawdust down on the ground around and so forth and put out these metal folding chairs. And this guy was preaching that night. And I went and I sit down near the back. And I'll swear he looked at me just like I'm looking at the guy with the red shirt on back there again. He looked at me, I think, the whole time. He never missed me, never took his eyes off me. It's like he had a, you know, a rifle and it was aimed right at me. And I knew it was my time. I knew the Holy Spirit was asking me to go forward. This is the time, you know. Whenever he said, we're going to have a song, I was halfway down the aisle. I didn't wait for him to get finished. I couldn't wait. I had to get down. I had to get to that aisle. I had to make my commitment to Christ. And of course, in those days, the pastor came down, you know, and greeted you and so forth, and it was a personal thing, you know, and so forth, and we had prayer and so forth, and I never doubted it. Those of you who stand next to me, if I try to sing like I was trying to do this morning, you know I can't sing a note and just make a joyful noise, I hope. But I was so happy for the first 3 or 4 months after this incident, I sang. I would sing in the field when I was out with my brothers and my dad working. I'd sing in the house after I got home from school. They wouldn't let me do it in school. My two older brothers went to dad more than once and said, Dad, can you please shut him up? And my dad said, leave him alone. It'll cool down, and it did, as it does with most of us. But I knew it was my time. I could relive this experience. I can close my eyes, I can smell the sawdust from the floor. When I was 13 years old. And if you don't have an experience like that, friend, I would say re-examine yourself. We don't choose Christ, he chooses us. All Christians are called, and there's no other way to become a Christian. Point number two, all are gifted. 1 Corinthians 7:7. Each has his own special gift from God, one of one kind and one of another. Now, you cannot say if you're saved, well, I don't have a gift, I can't do anything in the church. You're telling Jesus that he's a liar. If you're saved, God grants you at least one gift. Many people, a half a dozen gifts, okay? Our pastor, I use as an example a good bit, always talk about him when he's gone. I don't know if they're recording this or not, but he heard about the last time, he probably did this. But I think he has more than one gift, don't you?
Yes.
I mean, he's gifted with preaching, he's gifted with music, he's gifted with voice, okay? And he's a pretty good man. So he's got more than one gift. And it says, all are gifted, 1 Corinthians 7:7. Each has his own special gift. What do you do with this gift that you get from God? Okay? There's an answer for that in 1 Peter 4:10. As each has received a gift, employ it for one another as good stewards of God's varied grace. Okay? Now, 1 Corinthians 12:4-7 talks about one of the scriptures we had in Sunday school. There were varieties of gifts, but the same Spirit. There were varieties of service, but the same Lord. There are varieties of working, but the same God. What is Paul doing here? Why does he use these three separate examples? One about the Spirit, one about the Lord, and one about God. Because he wanted to emphasize the triune nature, the Trinity of God. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. And he said, to each is given a manifestation of the Spirit for the common good. Matthew 25:25 says, to each according to his ability. Now, if you get saved, it doesn't mean the next day that you can get up and preach in this pulpit. This is a position that has to be earned, and it has to be called, and it has to be something, you know, God has gifted you with. If it isn't, you won't do it. If you try to do it, you're going to fall on your face. Okay? The best example that I know is in Scripture. You remember the parable of the talents of the three slaves that his master put in charge of his business and territory as he left and was gone for a while? And he gave one of his servants 5 talents. This is a type of money. Okay? He gave another one 2 talents, and he gave another one 1 talent. That's where he's recognizing their ability, as the scripture says. He didn't give 5 to all of them, because one could handle 5 and deal with it. You know, and he did. He went out and he made 5 more talents. The one that he gave 2 also went out and doubled his money. He made 2 more and added to it. He had 4 talents. When the master came back and wanted to hear about what had happened, and he had to report to him. But the one that got 1 talent, what did he do with it? He went and buried it in the ground. Scripture tells us when he faces the master, he said, Master, basically what he's saying, I was afraid. I knew that you are a very strict man. I knew that you have high standards, and I was afraid of losing your money. So what happened to this person, this slave? The 1 talent that he had, he took it from him. Guess who he gave it to? The one with 5, because he has the best ability. And then this man that didn't do anything with his gift was consigned to total darkness, outcast, it says. So that's an example of how the ability comes to play, okay? And I believe Christ is saying the same thing to us today, okay? As a Christian, we're all gifted. And I think he's saying, now go and use your gift for the glory of God. Paul's example of the church being the body of Christ, and we as members of that church compose the body of Christ. And each member of the body has a different function or job. We had something about that in our Sunday school lesson this morning, how you recognize what does a church look like to you and so forth. many times there's a person in the church who's gifted in a particular service or a particular gift, and they tend to judge others based on their gift and how well they do it, and they look down their nose if they aren't doing as well as they should in the same gift that that person has. That's not right. Okay. Let me give another example closer to our church. I think everybody can understand. I don't think anyone here that's been here for any length of time at all, listened to our music and enjoyed it, would doubt Liz's musical ability. Where'd you get to, Liz? Did you leave there? There, okay. You're sitting right back there. Okay. And she has blessed my heart and blessed the hearts of many people in this church by being here and letting the Lord use her in the function where she has the ability to serve, and that is in music and singing. Anybody doubt that? I could see that very easily as being a gift of God. And Liz, I thank you from the bottom of my heart for being here and for your gift and for serving our Lord the way you do. Let's recognize her. Carry this burden alone either. Mick Eaton here. She's deserving of a hand as well. I'd put our musical program up against any church that I've ever been in my life, and I think we'd rate very high, if not first. Okay? Now, what if Liz decided everyone in this church had to devote themselves to become as accomplished as she is in the musical field? And that's the way she judges everybody that she meets under Christianity. I'd be on the bottom of the list. I'd fail miserably. Okay? I don't have that ability. My wife does. And she's up here singing. She's out here practicing 3-4 times a week. And she, the fun thing is, you know, I say, honey, don't you get tired of being involved in doing all this stuff? And she says, I enjoy it. And I think with the look on Lisa's face when she does it, I think she enjoys it. Okay. But Matthew 7:1 gives us an answer for this about this person judging based on their gift. It says, judge not that you be not judged. The point is that each one of us is responsible to develop the gift or gifts that we have individually, been given by God as a result of being a Christian, and we need to respect the gifts others have and don't judge their Christianity by their by your abilities against theirs whenever they're gifted in some other way. If we didn't have people with different gifts, if this church was nothing but a bunch of musicians, we'd have more fighting than you could handle. And something else I come to find out, musicians tend to be opinionated about the type of music they like. Third point, all are sent. John 20:21 says, Jesus said to them, again, and I emphasize that because it's important, peace be with you, and as the Father has sent me, even so I send you. And Jesus appears to the disciples now who are in a closed room with the doors locked. This is after his death on the cross, after his resurrection. And if you read the scripture, it tells you that the doors are closed and locked. And the scripture very easily says, and Jesus appeared among them. How did he get there? Nobody opened the door. Did he have a key? I doubt it. Jesus can go anywhere he wants to go, anytime he wants to. That's a fact we have to recognize. Okay? And he said again to them, my peace I give to you. Again he said, the Father sent me. Again he said, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. And again he said, I send you. Let's go back to John 15:16, the last part of that verse. John 15:16, Jesus said, I've chosen you, you haven't chosen me. And the last part of it says that you should go and bear fruit. Now, what's the fruit of a Christian? Faith. Faith, yes. But to be very succinct about it, the fruit of a Christian is another Christian. That's what we're to be about. If you take your Christianity and you do basically like the third slave did with his talent, and you go bury it or you go sit on it and never tell anybody about it, I'll let you finish that yourself. 1 Peter 4:10 says, as every man has received the gift, even so minister the same to another as good stewards of God. And this gift that they're talking about is a gift of salvation. When we truly know the truth about ourselves and come to see ourselves, as God sees us, we recognize our lost condition, and in our innermost being, we'll have that still small voice of the Holy Spirit, which is going to touch us and tell us and convict us of our sin and let us know that we need the Savior. Okay? That's the way salvation happens, or it's not valid. All are called, and for those who respond, there are gifts. The greatest one is salvation, eternal life with your name written in the Lamb's Book of Life, and a peace that passes all understanding. Since Christ now lives in you to give you that peace in the form of the Holy Spirit. Number three, finally, all are sent. Finally, you were to go to a lost and dying world and share the salvation and personal knowledge of the truth about Christ, who he is, what he can do for you. And in closing, I want to leave you with Matthew 28:18-20. Now, this is the last chapter of Matthew, among the last verses of the last chapter of Matthew. It's after Jesus has been crucified and risen. And is very near to the end of it, close to his ascension, where he goes back to heaven to be with the Father. Okay. And he came and spoke to them again and said, all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go, they're being sent. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. And observe all things that I have commanded you to do. And lo, I'm with you always, even to the end of the age. What do we call that? The Great Commission. Right. I got it right. The Great Commission. That's binding on every Christian. If you say, well, I don't have a gift, that's wrong. If you say there's nothing in the church I can do, that's wrong. If you want something to do, ask the pastor. If you want something to do, listen to some of these people on the nominating committee when they call you and ask you to serve. We're looking for people to do jobs in the church. We're short in a number of areas. And it hurts me when the pastor has to stand up here on Sunday morning and says, we don't have anybody to deal with the kids today. Anybody want to do it today? There are the people to be in line to do this. For all of you who are Christians, I challenge you to use your gifts that God has given to you this week for the common good of the kingdom of God. And this sermon now has mainly been aimed at people that are Christians that know Christ as Savior and Lord. But if there's any present who do not know Christ as Savior and Lord, I ask you in the strong name of Jesus Christ to come forward if the Holy Spirit is touching you in any way. If you have the slightest, you know, urge or feeling that this is an action that you need to take in your life, I can guarantee you that's the Holy Spirit leading you. The devil or anybody associated with the devil is never going to encourage you to be saved. He's going to do everything in the world he can to stop you, to keep you from being saved. Because once you're saved, he doesn't have any control over you anymore. You're greater than he is. Because you've got Christ living in you and his Holy Spirit. Okay? And the devil knows this. So if you have an urge or a need to come forward and accept Christ as your Savior, I can guarantee you that's the Holy Spirit leading you. The scripture, I don't have it in mind. I didn't write it down. I don't know where it is in the Bible. But there's a scripture that says God will not always continue with man. In other words, is asking you through the Holy Spirit to be saved is not something you can depend on to happen again. I always thought the pastor was trying to scare people when he tell people, well, this may be your last chance. But people today, if you read the obituaries, are dying with all ages. And we're one young person in the paper today and one very elderly person in the paper today just in the obituary. I don't know how much longer you have. But if you have that feeling, you have that urge, you need to come forward today and make that decision. Okay? Listen to that still small voice telling you what to do. Okay? The Holy Spirit's never going to lie to you as the world does. The Holy Spirit is calling you. Please don't turn him down. I'll be standing here at the front to receive any of you that come and need to talk to me. And it may be that you're looking for a church home. If the Holy Spirit is telling you to join with us, we'd be happy and thrilled and overjoyed to have you come, you know, for membership in this church. I'll explain to you how we receive members. Again, with this church, which I'm proud of, it's not an open thing where you come up and I present you and everybody votes on you today and yay, you're a member. No, if you want to be a member, one of the things you have to do is you have to talk with the pastor. The pastor wants to get to know you and wants to know about your salvation experience. He wants to be satisfied, you know, and answer any questions that you have about the church and about our doctrine, so forth, before you get involved. He don't want you getting a pig in a poke. He wants you to know what you're getting involved in and what you're doing. And I think that's very appropriate. And I think it should be a matter for all churches to handle like that. Most churches don't. They don't take the time. We do. Okay. And maybe a third category, maybe you're a Christian. Maybe you've already accepted Christ as your Savior and Lord. And things just not been going right and you haven't been living for him. If that's true, this altar is open. And I'll be here to talk with you, pray with you if you need me to. But you don't need me. You can do that on your own. Maybe you need to get back on track with the Lord. There's nothing like living for him on a day-to-day basis. I like it. I can recommend it. He says, I have come that you might have life and you might have it more abundantly. So if you want to live that abundant life, I welcome you this morning. Please come down. Father in heaven, thank you for this beautiful day that we have to worship in your house. Thank you, Lord, that we have the privilege in this country of doing this openly and freely. And I pray we'll never lose this privilege. Thank you for that. And now, Lord, open our minds and hearts as we welcome your Holy Spirit and its presence and its working in this audience and in the hearts and minds of the people here. For those that just need to pray and get right with you that are Christians, I pray you touch them. For those, Lord, that don't know you as Savior and Lord, I pray you touch them and ask them to come forward as well. In the name of Christ, and in the strong and sweet name of Christ, amen.
Amen.
Stand. Please join me in singing hymn number 330, Amazing Grace, first and last verses, or first and fourth, whichever.
Receiving God's grace.
probably just asking you to go with us, be with us, and Father, just help us to put our trust and faith in you. We ask all this in